Okay, let's start. So let's watch this video. We already tried this experiment last class, but it failed, right? So this person has journeyed in a different way, which works. So we'll again try this method, and if it works, I'll show you this method. See, it moves like this. This is like evidence of the presence of atoms and molecules. Yeah. Even though we can't, so this, these are the smoke particles. Just see how you set up the primitive way of sinking that. This is the smoke cell.
There's no volume?
No, it's just recording it. It's self explanatory when you see the captions. So a laser has been fixed here. This is the smoke cell. And through a tube, rubber tube, the cigarette, burning cigarette is entering this one. So the smoke from the burning cigarette will go through this tube. When you open this door, the smoke will enter. So that when you close it, the smoke is trapped inside this small region and the laser beam will light up the smoke. So you can see through the, so this whole setup is kept below the, is directly the glass line in a copper microscope. So you can see. These are the smoke particles. So they are just randomly vibrating. So how do you explain why the smoke particles are randomly vibrating? If there is gravitational force acting downwards, they should just come down. But instead of coming down, they seem to be staying in the same place and then vibrating randomly. So this was the first question. At the time when they did not know about atoms and molecules, they were wondering why is it happening. So who can explain?
What?
Why it happens?
Brownian motion.
This random motion of smoke particles is called as Brownian motion. So why does this happen?
Sir, but we usually touch after that term randomly.
Wait, I can't understand. Speak
slowly. So when all the particles, when they collide with each other, first they were randomly, if they were vibrating, then they collide each other, they go to like randomly.
What is colliding? Which particles are colliding?
Smoke particles.
No.
This is vibrating.
You saw each smoke particle was alone and it was just vibrating in its place. You can see the video carefully. Smoke particles were not colliding with each other.
Yeah, sir.
Okay, this is another video. Even here you can see any one particle you see. It's just alone, it's not colliding with another particle. This whole view is in air, smoking air. So why is it doing like that? It was in air. You can't see anything in air. It's invisible. So why is the smoke particle randomly moving? Yes, Daman?
So what I think it's because
be loud.
The, because the mass is less than the air resistance.
Air resistance. Air resistance is the force which opposes the object which is moving through air. So the smoke particle will try to move in which direction? Which direction will it try to move? What forces are acting on a smoke particle? If this is a smoke particle, it has a mass m. What forces act on it?
Mass will act.
Huh?
That mass will act downwards.
Mass does not act on anything. Mass is not a force. Mass is amount of matter. Force only acts on things. So what force will act on a smoke particle of mass m? Shivan, what forces will act on a smoke particle of mass m? Praveen, yes, sir. I don't have to repeat the same question third time, yeah? What is the question?
What is the more partner in
what is the question? You're telling your own words.
Why are the smoke?
I asked Amin.
Why are the smoke particles moving like, you know, the
no, that was the question I asked.
Why are the smoke particles moving randomly?
I didn't ask you. Amin, what is the question?
Air molecules.
What forces are acting on a smoke particle of mass and Adit, what is the answer? Because you didn't think. Which direction does it act? What are you doing on the team? Keep the back down. What are you writing?
I'm
writing. This is not the right thing. Keep it inside. Keep the essay inside. I said keep it inside. Inside meaning out of myself. Yes, Ali.
Yes.
Which direction does gravitational force act on a small particle? Okay, what are the forces? What are the forces can act on a small particle of mass m?
Air resistance.
In which direction will it act? Because it will, this, due to the weight, the small particle will like to go down. And air resistance will oppose any motion, no friction. So air resistance, let us call it F. Air resistance. It acts upwards.
Yes,
so it should slow it down.
Yes, sir.
So you should observe smoke particles slowly going down.
Yes, sir.
Agree? But what did you see in the video?
It
will just take the same place and going like this randomly. Yes, come in.
So because the gravitational force and the air resistance act was seeing up the air resistance moving upwards and the gravitational force will be coming down to the same.
So the net force will be some single force.
Yeah.
So due to the net force, it should either go down or it should either go up.
Yeah.
How can it keep wiggling up and down, so side, left and right, front and back?
So the net force is zero, that's
why. So net force is zero, it should stay at constant velocity or state of rest. According to Newton's first law of motion.
Yeah.
It was not at constant velocity, so it was not at rest.
Yeah.
It was not oscillating also, it was having random motion back and forth in random direction.
So because of all the collisions with other particles.
Yes, sir.
With which particles?
So the other smoke particles.
That's what I'm telling. We saw in the video one smoke particle was not colliding with other smoke particles.
So we couldn't see the collisions, sir.
Smoke particles can be seen.
Sir, it is absolutely.
Smoke particles are all of same size.
Not just smoke particles, sir. Not just smoke particles. Air particles in the air.
Which other particles?
So like, sir, it's a particle of other particles other than smoke.
Sir,
this is an interesting discussion.
Sir, air molecule.
The water bottle with a base between plastics. What do you say?
Sir, air molecule.
Air molecule.
So, what did I say? I'm going to go to the end of the student.
Recording. So if this is a smoke particle, you have these air molecules. You are in LKG, UKG or what, yeah? In 30 minute class, this is going on outside. So this red dots represent the air molecules which have much less mass, but they have higher velocities. And they are constantly bombarding it from all sides at random intervals of time. As a result, the net force due to the combined collisions of all the air molecules will keep changing its direction and magnitude randomly. So due to that, sometimes it becomes here, sometimes it becomes here, sometimes it becomes here. You get it? Okay, now Sahil will summarize the explanation. Come on, put it back down. Tell me, why do smoke particles exhibit no emotion? How do you write it in the exam? They ask you. We have discussed the whole thing. I just want you to look at it. You didn't understand. Come in with recap.
We saw in the video that the air particles were moving up and on.
Louder.
They were moving tandemly, so which made us this is because they were colliding with the air molecules. And
once again, Sahil, are you listening now?
Yes.
After this, you have to explain, you can't escape.
Yeah. So we got to that the gravitational force is acting upwards and the air resistance is acting upwards, so that these particles are in the same direction, but still they are colliding with the air molecules rather than moving random direction.
Now, what did you not understand, Sahil? We love the
second part. The gravitation force that. It has to be, the net force has to be zero. No, I need to say that if the gravitation force is acting upwards and the air is acting upwards, then the particles should stay at the particular point and not move. So, but due to the air molecules present, so particles are moving and colliding with the air molecules, and that is the reason they are shown as moving right now.
Are you getting it? No?
I'll agree with that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, Sahil, you don't understand. Who can explain again? Adit?
Yeah.
Explain loud and clear. Step by step.
Basically, the smoke molecules of mass and.
Not molecules, smoke particles.
So, particles, smoke particles of mass have, which have gravitational force acting upon that, but they don't, which is downwards, and there's air resistance acting upwards. So, there's a net force created. But the thing is, we don't see them in dash, but we don't see them going up or down. But they're moving rapidly. And this is because of the collision of the other air particles.
Ask your question loudly, yaar. Everybody has to understand what is your confusion.
Because there are, they're not colliding with smoke particles because we can see the smoke particle collisions in the video. But they're moving randomly because of the collisions with the air particles, which are
molecules.
mass, so finally they will settle down. during the rings, and they may have some collisions also. So this is this could be an interesting experiment.
Right. Ah, yes.
So it's smoke in vacuum. Yeah.
So when we talk about Brownian motion.
Louder.
So when we talk about Brownian motion and the air particle that has mass m, which experiences gravity control and air resistance, so is there net displacement? Is there net displacement?
Net displacement will be there whenever the particle moves from one position to another position.
So
what are you asking?
So that's
is there net force you are asking?
So obviously there is a net force because it's so obviously there is net force because it's experiencing gravity and air resistance. But as a
when we see Brownian motion, the dominant forces are not the weight or air resistance. It's the force exerted by collision with the surrounding air molecules. Smoke particle is surrounded by air molecules on all sides, which we cannot see.
So
okay, now the question is, why can't we see the air molecules?
Too small.
They are too small. Our eyesight, which uses light to see the things, cannot resolve particles of that much small size. Now, what is the question? The dominant force is the collision force exerted by the surrounding air molecules. That's what prevents the smoke particle from going down, and that is what makes it jiggle in all directions. Now what is the question? This net force due to the collision by air molecules keeps changing direction. Because sometimes more collisions happen from this side, sometimes from that side, sometimes from this side.
So there is net displacement.
Displacement you can obviously visually see, right? It goes like this, then it goes like this. When you say what is the average displacement, it may be very small.
The motors are like a sound particle. So there is no net displacement when it's
okay, net displacement over what time period is zero, but over half a time period it will have a displacement, right? You start, if it's a longitudinal wave in this direction, the particle will go from here to here in half second. So there is a net displacement in half a second. But in one complete cycle, it will go back to standard position. So net displacement is zero in a complete cycle. Clear? Okay, now let's continue with our discussion. We are discussing evaporation, right? Yeah. Okay, this question is for... Okay. Tell me one thing. Why is evaporation so important? Why is evaporation important?
For plants, I'll say...
To maintain temperature of organisms.
One at a time, what?
To maintain the temperature of organisms.
Yeah. So for example, dogs. Do dogs have the ability to produce sweat?
No.
So how do dogs cool their bodies?
Licking their
nose.
Kissing
their nose? They keep their tongue hanging out of the mouth, right? So lot of heat is radiated out of the tongue. The tongue has a very huge supply of blood. So the heat directly goes from the blood and radiated out. So it doesn't depend so much on evaporation. But human beings depend on evaporation. This what you understood, right? Then what else? Why else is evaporation important in life? Yes. Precipitation, rainfall, snowfall. So in the land areas which are far away from any water body, the only way they can get water is through
precipitation.
And that can happen only if evaporation happens. But even more fundamental, life could not have originated on planet Earth if the process behind evaporation did not happen somewhere else. Can you guess? What is the process which is enabling evaporation to happen at all temperatures? From 0 degrees to
collisions.
So these particles are having collisions. So even if I started with all the particles having same speed initially, what will happen is randomly, suppose this is hitting it in this direction, and it tries to move in this direction, and one more particle again hits this and it again hits in the same direction. So four times in a row this particle hits it. Then four pushes it got in the same direction. So four times it accelerated in the same direction. It's a random coincidence. As a result, its velocity became very high. Whereas some other particle, same time these two collided. Even though two forces acted, they acted in opposite directions, they cancel each other out.
Yeah.
Again, these two collided at the same time. Again, random coincidence. Again, they cancel each other out. So it is not getting any force to accelerate at all. So its speed is very low. Low speed. Whereas this one, high speed. So after some time, you will find that even though you started moving all the particles at the same speed, after some time there will be a distribution like this, where this graph tells you number of particles. Okay, y-axis is number of particles or fraction. Let me explain what I mean. Suppose in this container there are totally 100 particles. Okay? And this x-axis tells you the distribution of speed. So it's like a histogram graph. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yes. So what this tells you is, suppose this is, let us say, 450. This is 110. This is also 110. Like so the maximum fraction of particles have a speed between 4 and 5 meters per second. Are you getting what I'm saying? I just found how many particles have a speed between 1 and 2 meters per second. And then I will suppose I get out of 115 particles, then on this graph maybe 15 by 100 is plotted. 15 by 100, listen, I create a table, number of particles, and speed range. So speed range can be 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, like that. And then I count how many particles are having the speed in this range. So suppose I get 2, 3, 4, 10, 7, 6, 5. So very high speed particles, the probability is very less. Very low speed particles also probability is very less. Most of the particles will have some speed in between. Okay? Now in this graph, what I will do is, I will not directly plot this because I can't compare between samples. I may have some other sample which has 1 million particles. You may have a sample which has 10,000 particles. So I can't compare my graph with your graph if I use this. So we instead use fraction. Fraction of particles. So even if your sample has 1000 particles, you will count how many particles are in each velocity range and take the fraction of particles. So 2 divided by, suppose we have 1000, some and I have a million. So whatever number I count in the page divided by my total number. Are you getting it? So then once we plot this fraction, suppose this 2 by 1000, 3 by 1000, like this. So whatever fraction we get, if we plot, all of us will get the same shape of graph. That's the amazing thing. If the gas has the same temperature, whatever gas you take, if it has the same temperature, then no matter how many particles are there in your sample, the distribution of velocities will have the same shape of graph. Fraction of molecules having different velocity ranges. So that's why, and if the gas becomes hotter, what do you expect? The maximum fraction of particles will have a speed in a lower range or higher range? Daman?
Daman?
At a particular temperature, Tamim, you don't have to do this. You have to do it. Some students don't like it when you do this. So at a particular temperature, the shape of the graph is like this. Now, if I heat up the gas so that the temperature increases, how will the shape change? Will it become like this, or will it become like this? Option A, option B. How will the shape change?
A.
So the maximum number of particles will have speeds which are higher at higher temperature. Because temperature is a measure of the average translational kinetic energy. Agreed? And you are also understanding why this variation in speed comes about. Even if you start with a gas containing particles with same speed, due to random collisions, sometimes collisions will happen in the same direction, making the particles get high speed. Sometimes collision will happen in opposite directions, so that if the particle is going like this, the collision happens from the opposite side. So it slows down. So those particles will end up with low speeds. Right? Clear? So on average, the distribution will be like this. It is called as maximal Boltzmann distribution. You can just note it down. In higher grades, we will again learn this. Maxwell Boltzmann distribution of velocities. So this is what is responsible for some particles having very high kinetic energy.
So Maxwell
Boltzmann distribution of velocities.
When you increase temperature,
more collisions will happen. Agreed. Collisions will happen at faster speeds, and so the shift of average speed, that is more particles containing the higher speed, more particles will have higher speeds now, because on average all particles will move faster. You believe?
That's Maxwell's
the shape of this graph. Y-axis will have fraction of molecules which have a particular velocity range. X-axis will have velocity ranges. Like a histogram graph. Okay, now what contributes to evaporation is these high energy particles. Always you will have few particles which have the maximum velocities. So suppose for evaporation to happen, for a gas molecule to escape from the liquid, it has to overcome the attractive force of the liquid molecule surrounding it. For that you need some minimum energy. Always you will have two molecules which have that minimum energy, which are at the surface. So those two will escape. That is called evaporation. If the temperature is higher, this fraction of particles with high velocity will be more. So evaporation rate will be more. Now you understand why if the temperature is higher, rate of evaporation is higher. Clear? Okay, now what other factors could affect evaporation?
Surface area.
Okay, Shyamal. Yes, if surface area of the liquid is bigger, evaporation rate will be
faster.
Why?
Sir, because the
particles will be louder.
Sir, because there will be more particles at the top, therefore more particles have the escape.
Yes. See, if you increase the surface area, it's like opening the door and making the door bigger. So yes, more people can escape out of the room. Otherwise, see, the molecule which is inside the liquid, it cannot escape, right? It is surrounded by water molecules from all sides.
Yeah.
How can it escape? Only the molecules at the surface have a chance of escaping, provided they have the minimum liquid energy. So if you make the surface area bigger, you give more number of molecules the chance to escape. Okay, what are the factors? One is surface area, one is temperature, Rishiket. Can you tell one more factor which affects evaporation? One is surface area,
another is temperature.
Density.
Wait, Rishiket.
So density.
What density? Density of what?
Of the
how does that have any role?
There was the surface area.
We already discussed
that.
So If you are not serious in class, how do you expect
to alter it?
You are not listening when I am explaining.
So pressure.
What factors have you discussed till now?
Temperature, surface area.
What about altitude?
Is any other factor?
Pressure.
Okay, pressure, how do you think pressure will play a role?
Sir, so, evaporation happens when the pressure of the liquid equals the atmospheric pressure.
That is for boiling. Vapor pressure of liquid, when it equals the atmospheric pressure, then boiling will start to happen. Vapor pressure is the pressure due to the molecules of the same liquid which are in vapor form. There is something called fractional pressure.
So, but I don't understand the difference.
Boiling happens at a fixed temperature, okay, and pressure. Whereas evaporation happens at all temperatures. Evaporation is happening due to the few molecules which have excess energy. Boiling happens because all the molecules will be able to escape at the same time. But mostly they will be escaping. Because the vapor pressure is equal to the atmospheric pressure.
Sir, gravity also impacts your
gravity. What? I thought you were lying louder.
Time of the day
and time.
Time of the day means it's not time which plays a role. What changes over time of day?
Temperature.
Yeah.
So humidity.
Humidity.
Very good. So if the humidity is already at 100%
saturation,
can evaporation happen?
No.
Why not?
So because the air particles are already full, because they not
feel. So the gap between the air particles is already full. Full in the sense it is not able to accommodate any more vapor particles at that temperature and pressure. Right? One more factor you have not thought of.
Light.
What? Think and then tell a factor. One more factor is missing. Based on this factor, one student of our school has already published a paper.
Amount of liquid?
What?
This factor which you have not thought of. When I give you a hot soup, what you do with the spoon? You directly put it in your mouth?
Wind.
You blow air over the soup, right? How does it cause cooling?
Sir,
it causes cooling in two ways. What are the two ways in which you blow air into the soup? How does it cause cooling? Yes, come on.
Sir, when we blow the air molecules, when they get the soup, the soup transfers into the air molecules.
Very good, that is one makeup. The air which we blow into the soup is obviously cooler than the temperature of the soup.
So it reduces the temperature.
It makes contact with the hot soup molecules.
It
is transferred to the air and then the air flows and escapes directly. What is the other way? Even if I blow air over the surface of the soup.
So it goes like the steam.
So it will increase the evaporation rate. Why? What? Shivya, can you explain? Suppose I have a spoon of soup like this. And I blow wind like this. Okay? Even then the evaporation rate will increase. Why? It's not touching the surface. It's going over the surface.
So it moves away the speed.
The air is going over the surface. Why does it increase evaporation rate?
So what steam part are there?
Huh?
Steam part are there.
Yes. See, it's like this. Suppose this room is fully packed with students and they are all trying to escape out of this single door. Okay? And suppose we have a lot of slow newcomers also who can't run very fast. And they are the ones by coincidence who are at the door. The B formers, A formers who can run fast are behind the B formers. Now they go around slowly and they are blocking the whole corridor. Can the fast B and A formers, can they escape out of the door? Because their way is blocked by the slow D formers who are not moving out of the way. So if now some S and S e-commerce come from outside and carry the decomposers away, creating empty space in the corridor. Then you people can rush out of the door. You getting it? That's what happens. If initially this space above the soup is already filled with vapor molecules which have evaporated, then the new soup molecules which want to escape cannot escape because the space is already blocked by this particle. So the wind comes and brushes them aside, creating again fresh space. Then fresh soup molecules can evaporate.
So which method is most efficient?
So you can drink both.
No, so it's more efficient.
Now the research paper which Sri Hari published was regarding this. He proved this cooling rate due to blowing of wind. Okay, it increases till a certain point with wind speed. Faster the wind speed, the cooling rate of soup will increase. But then it will increase at a slower and slower rate, and at a particular speed, say around 4 meters per second or something, the cooling rate will not decrease any further. Can you explain why?
As
why is there a limit on the wind speed?
So because there's a limit on how fast they can reach the minimum energy.
What?
The limit where the time taken for the particles to reach the minimum energy.
To reach the
minimum energy.
What minimum energy are you talking about? My question is, this wind speed, if I keep increasing the wind speed, the cooling rate is going to increase. The soup is getting cooled faster and faster and faster. Okay? But after I reach a certain maximum wind speed, the cooling rate does not increase after that point. It has reached the maximum cooling rate and it is stable at that. I cannot make the cooling rate increase anymore. Why?
Because there aren't enough particles coming out of the surface.
Yeah, so what does that have to do with wind speed? Why does a certain maximum wind speed exist? Initially, if there is no wind, cooling rate is minimum. At say 1 meter per second wind, cooling rate is faster, 2 meter per second faster, 3 meter per second faster, but then it is getting faster at a lesser and lesser amount, Finally, when it reaches 4 meter per second, it has reached the maximum cooling rate. After that, it does not cool any faster. That was what was observed experimentally. That's why he published this paper. But now the explanation is, I need to explain why. Yeah.
So because all the parts, say for Chennai, say all the particles that are coming out, the wind is already carrying them. If you increase the speed, then that will not make a difference.
Yes, that's what you. Thing is, at a certain speed, it is like cleaning it up instantaneously.
Yeah.
So the maximum, the contribution of wind is in clearing of the space. If the wind is fast enough, then it clears up the space instantly. The moment a soup molecule comes out, it's cleared up.
Sure.
Then what more help can it do? Yeah. It's already doing the full help it can possibly do. So there is no more further decrease in cooling.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, someone gave the first reason how wind affects the cooling basically.
The wind is made to blow directly into the soup. So it stirs up the soup. The wind molecules are having lower temperature. So heat is absorbed by the air molecules and carried away. It's cooling by contact. Okay, so we had a very detailed discussion on evaporation. Okay, this question is for Michigan. Read the question. Now I'll just ask this sequence, okay? Quickly.
Yeah.
Think of it as an exam question carrying, let us say,
5 marks.
One mark. So tell me the point for which I can give you the mark. You won't get marks for words. Louder.
This called kinetic even due to the moment.
Yes. Kinetic refers to movement, and in kinetic model of matter, we describe matter as being made up of particles which move randomly with different speeds.
And have kinetic energy.
Okay, Chintesh. Are you?
Plasma.
Very good. Plasma has a maximum kinetic.
Gas.
Gas is
what are two levels of gas. Level gas बात
बाकी होती है ना
technically current is plasma
हाँ पर gas
solid
तो homework is do the problems related to this topic
gas नहीं बोला